I'd like to invite Ms. Usha Thorat, ex-deputy director of the Reserve Bank of India. She's been one of the key players in the Indian Central Bank's efforts towards promoting financial inclusion. Mr. Pankaj Khandelwal, chairman and MD of INI Farms, which focuses on agri-consulting and farm management. Welcome, Mr. Khandelwal. Shri Pravesh Sharma, IAS, Managing Director, Small Farmers Agribusiness Consortium. Pravesh is a member of the Indian Administrative Service since 1982 and has been working in food security, agriculture, rural finance, rural development, and natural resources management. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Mr. P.N. Vasudevan, MD and promoter of Equitas Microfinance Private Limited, which is based out of Chennai. Prior to starting Equitas, Vasu has had a long, illustrious career in banking. I'd also like to invite Ms. Rajni Bakshi, freelance author and journalist. She's the author of Bazaars, Conversations and Freedom for a Market Culture Beyond Greed and Fear. Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, and Vineet, I hand over to you.
So now, since we have the social entrepreneur out of our way, possibly the time to actually take to the debate whether they have a right to actually deal with the population that they want to deal with. One of the key debates that we have actually been seeing really played out on the ground is who actually owns the development agenda. And why should there be a development agenda? Partly because we elect a government that actually is responsible of bringing about development. And therefore, possibly the role of social entrepreneurs should not exist. It's a fact of life that the development agenda is actually owned by the government, not because it's a responsibility that they take on their own shoulders. And wherever there is an inefficiency that leads to actually some of us trying to plug those inefficiencies and in the process get qualified as social entrepreneurs. So the discussion that we are going to have here has some people who have experience with the government and they don't represent the government point of view. Pravesh was very categorical that I make that clarification. At the same time, we have people who are from the domain that qualifies as social entrepreneurship. We still are trying to figure out what exactly it means. One thing it surely means is a lot of people who actually qualify as that do deal with people who are slightly deprived or majorly deprived, a fairly large cross-section, but that's where we have been playing for quite some time. I would actually like this panel to debate four or five key points. One of them actually is there a position that we can actually take where the ownership of the development agenda can actually be co-owned between the social entrepreneurs and the government, not forgetting that there is a very large civil society sector, which Ranjini will not forget to remind me of, has a big role to play in this. Another critical question that I would actually like us to discuss is the problem that we are faced with is so large that government is really the right authority to play in it. But because there are a lot of small gaps that are left, and I think a question that needs to be asked, does social entrepreneur really have a big role to play in the bigger picture? In the smaller picture, we surely have a role to play, but does on the larger context we play a role? I think some very contentious issues that we need to really discuss and debate is what happens in case social entrepreneurship or social entrepreneurs find themselves in a slightly hostile situation with the government. Mind you, the government is not only an actor and a player and a regulator, but could also actually be the decision maker in case you have a hostile position with them. Some advice from those who have some experience with the government might come handy for some of you and some of those who have just won the awards in case they start playing on the wrong side of the table. Maybe one of the key points that we can end up with is there are ways and examples in which, actually before we end that point, are there ways where social entrepreneurs, are there examples that we know of where social entrepreneurs have worked with the government? But one final thing that I would actually like everybody to comment on, very briefly though, is what happens when the perception about social role clashes with the perception about profitability. That's something that we have actually dealt with more so about social entrepreneurs who are following the for-profit model, And that's a challenge that we have continuously faced. And in a very short period of time, actually some time back, we have seen play out in the microfinance space. Not taking too much time, maybe I would like to start with Rajni. And Rajni, we would... the critical point, Rajni, is 5 minutes, cover all the points. And I would like each one of us to actually speak about it. And then we'll throw open the agenda to the public to interact with us, partly because we have all kinds of audience, both on the panel and outside.
Thank you, Vineet. Is this on? Thank you, Vineet. Actually, I'm going to start by challenging what you said about the government owning necessarily the development agenda. And I think what we've seen over the last 20 years is a conflict that now needs to fade away, which is that for the first 30 years of independence, we thought that, well, 40 years, that the government has to completely own the development agenda. And for the last 20 years, we were told that the market has to own the development agenda, or at least for the last 16 years or so. And now, more recently, we are told that there is a social enterprise sector that has to come in between and somehow make up for the shortcomings or the missing elements in the DNA of both. So what I'm suggesting is that all three of these are overlooking one thing, that there's such a thing as samaj. And I'll just illustrate this very briefly through the story of water. And I think that's why these forums are very exciting and your awards, instituting these awards is so exciting. Because if you'll notice, as a pattern developing, the most exciting enterprises are those that are in some way tapping those social energies. So in the case of water, if you look at Rajasthan, and if some of you are familiar perhaps with Anupam Mishra's work, and if you're not, I'd suggest that you look up his TED talk. It pretty much encapsulates in 18 minutes what they've done. You have an area of in long-term scarcity. Okay, people have been living in this arid zone, and so over centuries they have developed systems of maximizing that essential resource of life in ways that today most of our technologies and our bureaucratic systems cannot even begin to imagine. And so my point is that can we take this debate to really the more fundamental question that what releases social energies to find solutions? And I think, in fact, I'm hoping that somebody will bring up the question of microfinance. If I may just switch the issue to another sector. That was a sector where, in fact, the social energies created certain very innovative methods of bringing together cooperation, collectives, collaboration. And what happened when those social strengths were tried to be turned into a business model? What we lost, what we gained is not for me to say. There are other experts here who I hope will talk about that. But really, I think the question is, in what ways can this larger social energy constantly rethink what are the values that we want at the base of the development enterprise? And are we going to make room for collaboration and cooperation? And then the government supports those energies and those, and where then we can fight the government where it is going counter to those values? Or are we just going to stick to, you know, data point and results and not worry about the value structure? I'm sorry, I don't know if that's very confused.
Well, as an author, you have always confused a lot of us, so I think it's not a bad start to that. But I'll actually try to come back to somebody who is known to make very specific comments. Vasu, maybe a story from you may actually excite the audience. Vasu actually is used to telling stories. Every time I ask him to make a comment, he starts with a story. Sometimes it's somebody taking away the wife, or sometimes some people doing something else. Maybe Vasu, if you can give us a good story to talk about your relationship with the government as a social entrepreneur.
This time it's going to be a real life story. So when I come from the microfinance sector, so in the last few months we have been having lots of issues. So we are based out of Tamil Nadu. So I just wanted to be, you know, in touch with and be sensitive to the responses of the Tamil Nadu bureaucrats to the sector. So I have been in touch with some of them, and I did meet one senior bureaucrat. And so we were having a discussion, and so I said that, you know, I was explaining to him about the role of microfinance, how it actually fits a certain requirement from the population and things like that. So he said, yeah, I know all about that. I have read a lot of articles and all that. And I know that you're having doorstep delivery and all that. I know your cost is high. So what's your learning rates? I said, 26%. He said, that's a good rate. So I was a little taken aback. I thought, okay, maybe we have a very mature or very, forward-thinking bureaucrat here. So he appreciated the 26 is still a good rate. And I was kind of rushing in to say that, sir, actually 26 is still a little high, you know. We do want to reduce it over a period of time. Then he said, no, it's good for you. So that really put me back. Then I said, okay, I'm not going to get too far with this guy any longer on lending. He's caught me on the wrong foot. So I said, let's try a little different tactic. So I started off with a lot of the social activities that we do for our clients. So I started off with a health camp and said that, you know, we run a very large number of health camps. He cut me in and said, you're running health camps? Who asked you to run? We have just sanctioned 400 crores in the last budget. Our health ministry is doing that. We are running a lot of health camps and we run eye camps, we run general checkup camps. We do a lot of things and 400 crores we have just sanctioned in the last budget. So I said, okay, that's also out. Then I thought, okay, maybe we should try something on skill development because we do a lot of work on skill development and I was not sure whether the government is doing skill development. So I said, sir, we run a lot of skill development camps, you know, over 100,000 people. He cut in and said, what, you are doing skill development? We have an entire department called MSME and they are doing exactly that and we've just sanctioned 100 crores for them to do about 50,000 people they have trained last year. We want to increase that going forward. Why are you doing this? They said, okay, let's drop that also. Schools, I was about to start that they have thousands of schools. I have two schools, so that I knew is not going to wash. Then I thought tuition centers, we run 50 tuition centers. I know government does not run tuition centers. So I thought I'll pitch in with my tuition center. I said, sir, you know, we also run 50 odd tuition. Tuition centers, why are you running tuition centers? We are running schools. And you know, the Tamil Nadu dropout rate is the lowest in the entire country. And the pass percentage is increasing all the time. We are having about 80-85% pass percentage. Why are you running tuition centers? Who asked you to run all this stuff? So I think that's the response. I mean, to be serious, I think that's an individualized response. It is not necessarily the entire bureaucrat's response because parallelly I did meet another pretty senior bureaucrat and he was exactly the opposite. The entire response was different and he traveled with me all the way from Chennai to Trichy to watch one of our schools in motion and out of his own personal interest. So I think you have different set of people, but at the end of the day, so what's the government's view on what we call a social sector? Actually, I'm anyway totally confused on the stuff social sector. What is social sector? What is commercial sector? You know, if you run a water facility for the poor or a health facility for the low income category of people, is that a social or a commercial venture? You know, if it's a, it's always deemed to be social, so you're supposed to run it, however you run it, it is good. It doesn't matter you charge very high or you give a pathetic service or you take a lot of donations which is not accounted properly. Nothing is material, you're running it as a not-for-profit, it's good. And on the other hand, you run it on a for-profit model and you do it extremely efficiently, give much better service, much lower cost and be very transparent, totally accountable, but it's still deemed to be bad. So this social versus commercial is anyway a completely confusing thing. But I think, just to conclude, I would say that, to understand what the government believes or what the government thinks on the role of social entrepreneurs or even, let's not call it social, private entrepreneurs on areas touching the low-income segment, I think the answer to that question is not very clear at all because the government itself is a very ill-defined body. We don't know whether it's a minister or the bureaucrat or the current government or the next government. So I think it's very confusing and that's the situation we are in.